joining us this first Sunday of August, both those of you here in person and those of you joining us online. We continue our service on page number 4 of your bulletin or page 355 of your Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thanks be to God. justice and righteousness of David.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and fall down before his footstool. He is the Holy One.
Moses and Aaron among his priests, and Samuel among those who follow us today. They call upon the Lord, and he answered them.
He spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept his testimonies and the decree that he gave them.
The Lord our God answered them again. You are not angry, yet yet punished us.
Our lesson from the New Testament comes from the Epistle of Peter, Peter 2, 1, 13 through 21. I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to refresh your memory, since I know that my death will come soon, as indeed our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. And I will make every effort so that after my departure you will be able at any time to recall these things. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure. she was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things that they had seen. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Honor or memorialize fulfillment of that statement as James, John, and Peter experience this physical revelation of Christ's glory. But I also have questions about that interpretation, despite how ingrained it is in church culture and history. My first reason is that even though he's giving us a glimpse of something unusual, Luke never specifies that the apostles are seeing the kingdom of God anywhere in this passage. He doesn't even mention the kingdom for another 30-plus verses. What he does give us is a limited vision with a limited audience happening over a relatively brief period of time. If he's trying to describe God's kingdom, then it doesn't really extend much beyond the physical Jesus himself. While you could definitely play with the theology that that suggests, it doesn't offer a whole lot of hope on a practical reality as it currently is level. Secondly, the standing here in Jesus' statement could also be legitimately translated as taking a stand there, in which case the people who will not taste death aren't necessarily the ones listening to him on that particular day in history, but those who might be present someday at the coming of the Son of Man in his glory and the glory of the Father and the holy angels. So it might not have anything to do with his contemporary audience. He could be saying that some alive at the time of what we think of as the second coming won't have to experience death. The wording doesn't demand an either-or stance, but it does introduce enough of a question to make me wonder if it's the text that's guiding our understanding and application of what Jesus is saying, or if our theology and tradition might be driving the choices we're making when translating his words instead. However, none of this leaves me anywhere helpful. I'm still pretty much lost in regard to the point of the Transfiguration. Maybe it's just a theophany, something designed to prop up our understanding of Jesus as God. Maybe it's some sort of weird temporal distortion. Maybe Luke is trying to tell us that Jesus himself is the kingdom of God. Or maybe I'm looking at this way too hard, paying so much attention to the brush strokes and dabs of color that I forgot to look at what the entire painting is. Pulling back a bit, I settle into the question, what if the Transfiguration isn't supposed to be a glimpse of God's kingdom? What if Luke hasn't been attempting to show us a minuscule slice of heaven breaking through to earth? There's no question this is a window into Jesus' glory, and it's certainly a strong message that Jesus is the hinge point of history and representative or manifestation of God. But what if we've distracted ourselves with all of the noise, the lights, and the spectacle? What if, when we imagine that we're looking at Jesus here, we're actually getting lost in the dreams of glory, honor, and power we long to claim for ourselves? Pulling back to the really big picture, the overall point of Luke's gospel is to get us to follow Jesus' example. We look at everything happening to and around him, but if the ancient world determined your character, your core identity, based on your actions, then we should be training our attention on how Jesus is acting and responding. And when we look at that, we see surprisingly little here. Jesus' actions in this story all take place in the first 1.5 verses. He takes the three disciples, climbs the mountainside with them, and prays. Everything after that point involves the actions of others. The apostles see. The prophets hear and talk to him. Peter asks about setting up shrines. And finally, a cloud envelops and speaks to them. Jesus has done nothing during the course of this event. At least nothing that we can emulate. Maybe that's why on Transfiguration Sunday, this passage is paired with the following story. possessed boy that the other disciples couldn't heal. Because that's when and where we finally see Jesus' character in relation to this dazzling event, which, from what Luke tells us, he more or less ignores. The three apostles won't open their mouths for years, and Jesus doesn't ever appear to have mentioned it to anyone. So despite the experience, the awe and wonder, the glory heaped upon him, he simply goes on. This amazing event happened, but it doesn't really seem to alter who Jesus is. He doesn't try to grasp that moment and carry its splendor with him. He doesn't become any more authoritative or demanding than he's already been. He just goes back to everyday life, where we find him once again revealing the kingdom of God, not with lightning and thunder and explosive signs, but by settling down to heal a child no one else had been able to help. He steps out of this appearance of glory and goes straight back to serving others, not to spread his own fame or because the parent or child proved themselves to be particularly deserving, but because that's simply who Jesus is and what Jesus does. Jesus comes down. He comes down as the bread of heaven to feed us. He comes down as the living water to sustain us. He comes down as the light of the world to guide us. He comes down both with and as the presence of God. Because it turns out that God isn't found in the bombast and pageantry and self-aggrandizement that we all expect. God doesn't demand accolades or expect parades or find a purpose in flattery and fawning. You'll never find God in those things, no matter how hard you look, because God doesn't lift himself up for all to wonder at or fear. God comes down. Glory, power, and command, all the things we think God would display by right, are more commonly traits of empire, the antithesis of God's kingdom. But God is love. The kind of love that manifests through and within action. Jesus didn't obsess about or advertise his own significance, and neither does God. God exists in, among, and through us, not through transfiguration, not through grandeur and majesty and renown, but through quiet, common, everyday, and perfectly doable acts of love. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Turn the word of the Lord. Let's stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead
and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Page 383 in the Book of Common Prayer.
Have mercy on us, forgive us, that we may know my will and walk on the way to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace of the Lord.
Peace of the Lord to you.
Peace. How are you?
I'm well.
Good.
How are you?
Good and better.
Good.
Morning.
Why did you leave?
Peace to you.
Just a little dizzy. I do get dizzy. I don't know. I don't understand what triggers it.
Peace of the Lord.
And there's not a doctor that
knows.
Of course. Good morning. Good job, Virginia. Good job. Always.
I could have read for you. I didn't know what you came.
That's okay. That's all right. No worries. I love it. It's fine.
Going on today. This is the final Sunday
birthday.
If you'd like to join me in a prayer for birthdays, you'll find out on page 830 of your Book of Common Prayer. Page 830, prayer number 51. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may the peace which passes understanding abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Happy birthday.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death,
we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be made acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with Mary and Andrew and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
In the breaking of the bread.
you accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.